As far as your eyes can see, men, women, and baby slaves come into the land of liberty, where life's design is already made. So young and so strong, they're just waiting to be saved. Oh, so many fish in the sea. Widget, riding on the wave. We are riding on the wave.
Good afternoon. My name is Ishmael Al-Islam. I am your MC. For today, I will be introducing the main speaker and others for this celebration of our ancestors. Thank you for tuning in to our annual celebration of Black Holocaust Remembrance Day. Today is when we give thanks to all of those who have gone before us in the fight for self-determination, whatever form they chose to do it. For those who would like to donate, who are watching on social media, the links have been provided for you. And we thank you for your support. It is very much needed. We remember our ancestors on this day with honor and some sadness in many cases. Our goal is collective unity to show the power of this unity in the spirit of self-determination. We're at a moment in time when we must determine our own fate or perish in the attempt. I'd like to tell you a short story very quickly. You heard the song Ship Ahoy playing as we began the broadcast. I like to imagine that the words self-determination or perish were coming out of our ancestors' mouths. as they were being forced on ships by strange-looking people with chains and loud and angry shouting with aggressive, violent attitudes. I like to imagine the horror of being locked down in a small space in the hull of a ship, terrified of the thought of what are these strange people doing to us, and why were they doing these things to us? Where are we going? Why did these people take us from our land? I like to imagine being in the bottom of the ship, just being there for days without sunlight and seeing nothing, and then being brought up to the top of the ship and to see the rays of the sun glaring down on your skin, but nothing but water and no land. I like to imagine how our ancestors felt in saying, if I just could jump and swim back home. Yes, sir. Just jump off and swim back home. I like to imagine the screaming, the terrors that our mothers had to endure while these strange people forced themselves upon them. The question on their minds, if I could just jump over, was a reality at that moment in their minds. Fast forwarding to the reaching of a land that was strange to them and wondering, why are we here? Some of our ancestors, being from the same area or tribe, sold off to more strange-looking people in a strange land, speaking a strange language, seeming to be savage, an unimaginable horror. This fate, I like to imagine, being forced to eat strange food and work from sun up to sun down every day of their lives until they were either sold or died or ran away. This is how I see our ancestors, yes, sir, going through the terrific horror, yes, of slavery in the Western Hemisphere and the diaspora. Yes, I also want you to understand, if you really want to know the strangeness of these people and how they thought of us politically, you should study the Dred Scott case, yes, the Supreme Court decision, yes, by Justice Taney, 1857. Yes, you could then begin to get a feeling of how the entire European nation view our people. This is the day of our celebration of our ancestors.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Absolutely.
I would like to take a moment and just thank a few of them for their determination. There's many that we should thank, but I will just name a few. Marcus Garvey, Noble Drew Ali, Queen Mother Moore, Ray Jenkins, yes, sir. Paul Robeson, William Patterson, Malcolm X, yes, sir. Harriet Tubman, Denmark Vesey, yes, sir. And countless others who should be honored. I'd like to thank, most of all, in our time, the teacher of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, whom we know as Master Farad Muhammad, a man who came from the East. For it was he that brought us the understanding of our people and the understanding of the European people and both natures of both. That's important, to know the natures of ourselves and the European.
Yes,
sir. One being of a good, or what they call godly nature, the other being of a evil nature. I like to thank the Honorable Elijah Muhammad for birthing us into the knowledge that we are here without justice, without freedom, without equality, and that we must unite to govern ourselves in a land of our own. I would like to read just a small statement from him in Message to the Black Man, page 223, the second paragraph. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad states, America was not founded to guarantee the freedom and equality of the black man and woman. And indeed, she is not seeking to grant these privileges to our people today. Think about this. 1965, he projected that thought. We are now in 2022, and you still do not have that privilege.
That's correct, sir.
I'd like to thank Mr. Muhammad, Silas Muhammad, and his wife, Mashaki Muhammad, for their hard work for us in the international world to gain for us reparations, human rights, and the right to self-determination. With that, once again, we need to ask you to contribute. Donate what you can to help in the fight. We don't ask for much from our people, but do it, because we need your help. This fight is not only for this small band of people, it's for the entire Afro-descendant people,
yes, sir.
For the salvation of your generations to come. Help us help you. Mm-hmm. I would now like to go on with the program. I believe we will have a drumming procession. A song, I'm sorry. I believe we will have a song coming forth for you. Moving into a slave narrative performed by Mecca Shabazz from the city of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
Born here on the Norcom plantation. People remember the old master and missus as good and decent white folks, because they went to church and have a big, well-dressed family and kept all of her slaves clean and fed. The master's brother come up and visit with his nephew for his birthday. His nephew just turned 13. I was 15. The master and his brother decide I was what they gonna give the nephew for his birthday. Not to have, just to use. I'm gonna spare y'all the rest. The master, the doctor daddy, he was always after me too. He had me too, cause I was there, and that's what they could do. The missus, she didn't like it. She always studied looking at me like I was her worst enemy. After my third baby come out looking more like the master than the master himself. She come to my cabin the night after I give birth and takes the baby. I don't know if she killed the baby or sold it. I think she probably killed it. Cause after that, none of the house niggas could look me in the eyes after that. But they keep me on. And then one day, she started beating me with an iron kettle rod. She sure would have took me to my death that day. I lost my left eye that day, but the rod broke. And she stopped long enough to hear me say, God sure ground for you today, I say. I sure wouldn't treat a dog as you treated me. She stopped and commenced to falling on the floor crying. They long dead now.
Touching.
Yes, sir.
Can you feel it?
Yes, sir.
If you can't feel it, surely something is wrong.
Something is wrong.
We will move on. I would like to bring up a dear, dear brother of mine, a minister who cares wholeheartedly for the condition of Afro-descended people throughout the entire diaspora. I love his spirit, and I will waste no more time than bringing up Minister Dewan Mattyoon from Brooklyn, New York.
Thank you, Brother Ishbel. I appreciate that, sir. My name is Dewan Mattyoon. I stand here as a representative of our ancestors that went through that humiliating, degrading passage on those slave ships. My spirit is alive today because of what they endured, the humiliation. Hear me, my beloved. Many of our people that was brought onto those slave ships, some of them did commit suicide, jumped overboard. But there were a multitude that stayed, that endured. They endured with the hope of one day, if they can get through this ordeal that they found themselves in to no fault of their own, because they was born in a time that they had no choosing. They didn't choose that time. But yet here they were, victims in a period of time where slavery was the order of the day. So they found themselves having to endure surviving with this hope deep in the pit of their heart that if they could just make it through this ordeal, then perhaps they could find a way, some way, to be free. And when time began to elapse and pass, when opportunities presented themselves, some of them ran away for freedom because this is what was longing in their heart. They wanted to be free. But they were up against a power that prevented them from being free. So they had to submit to slavery. They had to submit to all of that humiliation with this thought in mind, that if I could just survive this, perhaps my children throughout time will one day wake up and be free from this. So I stand here today before you with the spirit and the honor of my ancestors. And I will not fail them, because today we want our people to know this, that they are the nation born in the midst of another nation. Two words I want to throw out there to you that I want you to ruminate on: Afro-descendant and war. I only got a few minutes, so let's go into this. Let's get down to the nitty-gritty. Afro-descendant, what is it? What is that name all about? Afro-descendant is a name that 19 leaders throughout the slavery diaspora, South America, Central America, the Caribbean, and I might add, the leader who represented the blacks in North America is Mr. Silas Muhammad. These 19 leaders came together and sat down in a meeting, a sponsored meeting by the UN, to ascertain a name, an identity that we would be known by globally and politically. Because see, we had no real political or global identity. So if we want to move forward, we have to have an identity. Negro is not an identity. We refuse, we reject the name Negro. Who gave you Negro? None of our leaders got together and said, let's sit down and let's decide that Negro is going to be our identity. The white man, white America, gave us that name Negro. We reject that vehemently. Then they came up and mocked us and changed it to a colored people. We didn't sit down together. Our educated leaders did not sit down and put their minds together and say, since we don't know who we are, since our identity has been stolen, destroyed, lost, let's choose the name colored people. The white man started calling us that, and we accepted that. Why did we accept those as our identity? Because our educated leaders accepted it. So therefore, we followed our educated leaders. They were schooled in the white man's language. They were schooled in the white man's ways. So we thought they were leading us the right way. We're Negro. We're colored people. After colored people, we're black Americans. After black Americans, we're Afro-American. After Afro-Americans, we're African Americans. And some of us even think that we are American. We are confused. But these 19 leaders sat down and say, enough is enough. We're going to choose our own identity. And the white man, nowhere on this earth is going to have anything to say with what we choose as our identity. And these leaders, men and women, bumped heads for 1 week to determine what name are we going to call ourselves by. Not just black people in America. We're talking about Central America. We're talking about South America. We're talking about the Caribbean. And we're talking about North America. What we're talking about, my beloved people, are 250 million souls that was made whole by these 19 leaders, because they agreed to accept the name Afro-descendant. What did that name do? What is the power that Afro-descendant gave us? Hear me, my beloved. It gave us the power to take our freedom from the hands of the white Americans. That's what the name Afro-descendant has done. Now, all of us, 250 million of us, we are one people now. Our global identity is Afro-descendant. Our political identity is Afro-descendant. Our nationality is Afro-descendant. And guess what? You don't even got to be a Muslim. I'm a Muslim, but my identity is Afro-descendant. We got Christians that are in the Afro-descendant nation. They're Christians, but their identity, their nationality is Afro-descendant. We got Garveyites. They may be following Marcus Garvey, and they can keep following Marcus Garvey. But their identity, their nationality is Afro-descendant. Now, why is that important? It is important because it gave us the right. Hear me, my beloved. It gave us the political and the legal right to self-determination. I don't think you heard me. It gave us the right to self-determination. So the Afro-descendants in America, since it gave us the right to self-determination, well, we said to ourselves, well, let's self-determine. Let's determine among ourselves that we want our own government. Behold, we carved out a government for ourselves right here in America. Yes. The United States government is aware of this nation. The United States government is aware of the existence of the Afro-descendant nation. It is a living, breathing entity that exists right here in America, right up under the nose of America. How come you don't know this? I will use that as a segue into the next word, war. You have to realize that America see you as an enemy. America see the Afro-descendant nation as an enemy. And because she see us as an enemy, what does war and tactics of war do when you're fighting the enemy? What kind of tactics do they use? Distraction, deceit, technology, lies, and diversion. This is what he's been using. Oh, let me add this. Misinformation. Because how come you didn't know that there's a nation here? For you, all of us. How come you didn't know that? Because it's not to the Caucasian man's interest to tell you something that's going to benefit you. So this is our job. We come before you standing on the shoulders of our ancestors to let you know you can free yourself from America. You don't need America. America needs us. Can you imagine 40 million people carved out of a society that's been misusing them, mistreating them, and using them as dogs and slaves? When you call yourself an African-American, what you're telling the white man is I'm your underling. We ask you, we conjure you, we call upon you to discontinue the use of African-American as an identity and embrace your new identity, Afro-descendant. This is what we're calling upon all of our people to do. Let all your brothers and sisters, your mother and father know. Stop calling yourself, identifying yourself as an African-American. We are Afro-descendants. That is our new political and global identity. And guess what? America can't do anything about it. So you don't have to be afraid. You don't have to be afraid that someone is going to come after you because you choose Afro-descendant. We are protected legally and internationally. By international law. We have a right to do this. And America knows it, but you don't. So we want you to know this because when you leave here today, we want you to go to www.afrodescendant.org and become a legal member of the Afro-descendant government. Don't be afraid. You're free now. You got the power. Those 19 leaders gave you the power to snatch it from the white man. Because as long as you call yourself an African-American, he is your master. I'm sorry. He made us African-American. He made us Negro. The weapon that he used was ethnocide. Ethnocide is the destruction of a whole people's culture and way of life. Go back. We had a culture before we were brought here. What happened to it? Ethnocide destroyed it through a system of ethnocide. Once we came through that system of ethnocide, what happened? We assimilated. Because how can we have our own religion, our own language, and our own way of life when it's been destroyed? So all we had was what our masters gave to us. And today, here we are today, calling ourselves Americans, African-American, when we're neither African or American. We are a new people because this name, Afro-descendants, was taken back to the United Nations and they recorded it on their books. Oh, yes. And they termed it ethnogenesis. Ethnogenesis means, in a nutshell, the birth of a new people, the rebirth of a new people. We're born again as a nation. We're a new nation now. And all we need for you to do, this is all we're asking you to do right now. If you don't want to take part of the government, so be it. But accept your identity. And then you got a nation backing you up. Oh. We have a constitution. We have a constitution whose primary ingredients are fairness, truth, freedom, justice, and equality. We have an executive branch where we have a president and a vice president, and she have a cabinet. That's right. We have a legislative branch, the people who make the laws. That's right. We call it Congress. And we have a judicial branch. So we have the structure of a government. And we're here to bring you the good news that is yours too.
That's right.
It's not just Muslims. It's all of our people who were brought from Africa over to the Western Hemisphere for the purposes of enslavement. This government, this newly formed government, the Afro-descendant government, belongs to all of us. Come home. We're saying now the doors are open. The white man has no more power over you. You can take the power right now. And tell the white man to take African American, to take America, to take Negro and color man and shove it where the sun don't shine. And don't be afraid of it. I'm proud to be an Afro-descendant. I declare myself an Afro-descendant. My ancestors will look back upon me this day and smile because they will see a black man having sold out and assimilated into our enemy's culture. I will not do that. And I've been fighting on this battlefield ever since I was 20 years old. And I'm going to fight until the day that I die. It ain't over until the day I'm gone. Because I got the spirit. A warrior. I got the spirit of freedom. That's burning in my chest. When I heard our beloved sister doing that slave narrative, my mind went back. Because I wanted to become a revolutionary. I wanted to fight this white man. I'm talking about with guns. But then I realized that would be suicide.
That's right.
So how can we get him? You want to get the white man? Give up the name African American and accept your new identity, Afro-descendant. And I'm going to say this, and I'm going to bring my brother back on. Why that's important? Because self-determination sets the stage for reparations. And see, reparations is not given to organizations, civil rights groups. Reparations is given to governments, nations. So if you become an Afro-descendant, you got a nation bagging you up. Now we can get reparations. I want to thank you for taking the time to come out here. And I want to thank all of those who are listening for tuning in and celebrating Black Holocaust Memorial. Love, honor, and peace to our ancestors. I bring back before you our beloved brother, Ishmael. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Excellent, excellent. Did you feel the fire?
Yes, sir.
You know, I'm listening to my brother, and I'm saying, is that how Denmark Vesey spoke? You know, I wasn't there, But I could imagine that type of fire coming out of Denmark VC. Or is that how Sister Harriet felt? Harriet Tubman, when she put that gun to their heads and say, either you gonna be free or you gonna die right here.
Yes, sir.
What you gonna do? Brother, that was inspiring.
Yes, sir. Very inspiring.
If our people can't feel that,
yes, sir.
Lay down. Lay down now. And let somebody kick the dirt on you. Because you're done. We will have a beautiful song coming by Sam Cooke.
But I know a change gon' come. Oh, yes it will. I go to the movie and I go downtown. Somebody keep telling me don't hang around. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes it will. Then I go to my brother and I say, brother, help me please. But he winds up knocking me back down on my knees. Oh, there've been times that I thought I couldn't last for long, but now I think I'm able to carry. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes it will.
Change is here.
Yes, sir.
Afro-descendant nation is growing right in your midst.
Yes, sir.
Change is here. Once again, if you want to donate, please. We have the donation online for those who are watching, and you can mail it in as well. That information is also provided for you. Change is coming, whether you read like it or not, self-determination. Let that word roll off your lips. self-determination.
Yes, sir.
You know, just to say that word means change. Because few of us understand that. Self-determination. Today's lecture is given on self-identity, collective unity, and the power of self-determination. These elements will be addressed by Minister Naji Muhammad, a member of the Afro-descendant nation, a brother who has dedicated his life and his family's lives to self-determination of our people, his love for our people has been nurtured by his teacher, Silas Muhammad, and he has some important information to give you. Please, please give him your undivided attention.
Yes, sir.
He is my brother and yours, if you will accept him, Minister Naji Muhammad.
Greetings to you. Welcome to Black Holocaust Remembrance Day. Today, we honor the memory of our ancestors. I would like to give a roll call and perhaps mention some of the names that Brother Ishmael may not have mentioned. Toussaint L'Ouverture, Gabriel Prosser, Nat Turner, Sojourner Truth, David Walker, Frederick Douglass, George Washington Carver, Booker T. Washington, Queen Mother, Callie House, Ida B. Wells,
yes, sir.
Garrett Morgan, Marcus Mosiah Garvey, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, Sister Clara Muhammad, Emperor Haile Selassie, Paul Robeson, Megar Evers, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., John Lewis,
yes, sir.
Muhammad Ali, Queen Mother Audley Moore, Queen Mother Dorothy Lewis, Dr. Khalid Abdul Muhammad, and we'd like to thank Minister Louis Farrakhan for his many years of service and others whose names weren't called. We must never forget, never, never, never forget whose shoulders that we stand on today.
Yes, sir.
Yes, yes, sir.
They are our giants.
Indeed, sir.
I want you to take a moment also to think about your family members who have passed on, stop for a moment and think about them for a moment. I know that we are busy, we have a real busy schedule, but we must take time and reflect, because we are standing on their shoulders. Think about your mother, your father, grandmother, grandfather, the many sacrifices that they made to raise you. Let me say this to you for the record. I think about my grandmother and grandfather often. For I revered them. I never wanted to disappoint them. That's how much I love them. And you probably did the same. So take this day out, or this moment, and think about our foreparents. In the night, the manhunt was so furious and the mortality so extravagant that whole regions were depopulated, entire tribes disappeared. The toll of human life in Africa by enslavement and death is estimated to have run beyond 50 million, according to the book Brown Americans by Edwin Embry. 50 million people. 50 million. I don't know if you ever touched that pain. I went back and I touched the pain.
Yes, sir.
And when you touch the pain, it just does something to you. Our ancestors suffered the worst Holocaust in human history.
Yes, sir.
Forcing them to walk through the infamous door of no return. Slavery was low, dirty, and an inhumane business. When the slaves were taken from Africa, they were cut off and chained to ships like beasts. Nothing more tragic than to be divorced from family, language, and roots, said Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Slave ships were named Angel, Black Joke, Black Prince, Brothers, Integrity, Justice, Liberty, Saint Joseph, Mary, and Jesus. Also, San Juan Bautista, aka John the Baptist. Satan should have been the name of one of their ships.
Yes,
don't you think?
Yes, sir.
They're naming slave ships after divine men are nothing more than the characteristics of a living devil. Wouldn't you say? I have something that I want to share with you. Years ago, I was working. I'm retired now. And from time to time, we would have conversations on the job, the brothers. Lunchtime. We talk about everything. And one day, this brother brought me a box. And I was wondering, I said, well, what are you giving me? And inside of the box were shackles and chains, ball and a chain and a whip. The brother said to me, I heard you talking about the seminar. That's what he called it, seminar, meaning Black Holocaust Remembrance Day. And he brought these shackles for me. And I'm just sharing this with you. If you just be yourself, people will come to your aid and people will help you. You never know who's listening.
Yes, sir.
But you don't have to be afraid to stand up for our people.
That's right.
I love Black people.
Yes, sir.
I love Afro descendants.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
The good, the bad, and the ugly.
Yes, sir.
Our brokenhearted ancestors, packed like sardines in the hold of the slave ship, shackled and chained together, where the stench of breathing air was so unbearable that the slave trader took them above on deck for fresh air and sunshine. And he had to cover his nose and mouth. Stored like animals, forced to defecate and urinate on each other in stomach-turning conditions. Some of our ancestors jumped overboard to be eaten by sharks, choosing to commit suicide rather than be transported thousands of miles to be enslaved in the Americas. Do you hear me?
Yes, sir.
I'm talking about you now. That's you on the slave ship. That's me.
Yes, sir.
Because you have some of the same blood that they had.
That's right. That's right.
So don't try to distance yourself. No. Uh-uh. That's you and me. And before we leave today, I think you will be in agreement with us.
Yes, sir.
Our ancestors. Bury me in the ocean with my ancestors, they cried, as they jumped from the ships, knowing that death was better than bondage. As untold millions died in the transatlantic slave trade, their savage and barbaric trip took about 2 months through the Middle Passage, fraught with danger, compounded by the ocean stormy, violent weather. Our ancestors came to America in chains. Not like the movie Coming to America, starring Eddie Murphy and Arsenio Hall, but real life human property, human cargo stolen from our motherland. Let me just pause here for just one moment. Did you know that John Hawkins, the slave trader, the sea dog, Queen Elizabeth's sea dog, had a 100 man kidnapping crew raiding village after village after village after village? Bringing our people to the Western Hemisphere. America don't love you.
No, sir. No, sir.
She don't love you. She have proved that she don't love you. She have proved that she don't love justice. On the dome of the Capitol, U.S. Capitol, is the Statue of Freedom. And there were slaves that hoisted up the Statue of Freedom. Look at that hypocrisy holding our people in bondage. With all humility, is there any comparison in our losing 50 million Africans in the Middle Passage to 6 million Jews in Germany? That's why we say 50 million of our people died. And you can't feel that? I can. When you touch that pain, you'll make that change. But if you haven't touched that pain, you're not going to change. You're going to continue to keep doing what you're doing. See, I've touched the pain. The pain. America, in 1776, became independent of the British crown and seems to have forgotten that self-determination was good for her.
Yes, sir.
It was good for America. Hasn't self-determination manifested America as a world superpower?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, brother.
Why is it self-determination good for us, good for Afro-descendants? It is if we exercise that power.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. That's correct.
It is time, Afro-descendants, for the world to hear our cry for self-determination.
Yes, sir.
They heard the cry of the Jews in the 1940s.
They did. Yes,
but what about us?
Yes, sir.
What about us? What about our people? All of our people who died, who made sacrifices. Those who were sharecroppers. Our foremothers who suffered from forced mixed breeding and rape. There were no laws that protected them. That's why we have so many different shades. Because there was no laws protecting our foremothers. Self-identification as Afro-descendants is the real power. Collective unity and self-determination will force America, it will force America's hand to pay us reparations.
That's correct, sir.
But you got to be willing, sir. Black man.
Yes, sir.
Don't you know that the black woman is looking at you?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Don't you know that our children are looking at you? The world is looking at you.
Real talk. Yes, sir.
When you going to come together? When you going to stand up, black man? I have some information that I'm going to give you today. And I'm going to put something on your mind.
Yes, sir.
This foolishness got to stop that you're putting down.
Yes, sir.
I want to show you the right path. The right path. Because you want to go to Capitol Hill. And I'm telling you, no, 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 don't go to Capitol Hill. The H.R. 40 bill to study reparations has been stalled in Congress for the past 33 years and has no provision for those Afro descendants choosing to leave America.
By slavery.
Yeah.
How do you come down?
I just think we're so far removed from the event. It was the original sin of the country, and I think let's just make it a more perfect union rather than looking backward, because I don't know where it stops when you do that.
Do you think the idea deserves to be studied further? Some of the 2020 presidential candidates have said that there should be a commission to study the idea further.
You know, I'm not there. I want to move. You know, listen, the original sin is real. We've tried to overcome all of our mistakes with the American Indian, you name it. We're not a perfect country, but we're trying to form a more perfect union, and I don't think this helps.
What's your take on the idea of reparations? Do you think that would be a good...
I don't think any person, black or white, is responsible for what someone else, black or white, did 150 years ago. And I think most Americans feel the same way I do. Slavery was reprehensible. It's indefensible. But reparations presents a whole different issue. And I believe in personal responsibility. And I just don't think someone today is responsible for what someone else did 150 years ago.
How is this issue from a Louisiana standpoint?
You see what you're going to run into, the opposition?
Yes, sir.
If you go to Capitol Hill, if you go to Congress,
yes, sir.
I want to show you the power of self-determination.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I want to show you the right path.
Yes, sir.
Not the wrong path. I'm your brother.
That's right. Yes, sir.
I feel the pain. So I'm going to point you in the right direction.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
In 1951, 23 major international Jewish organizations showed the world the power of collective unity and self-determination when they met at the Conference on the Jewish Material Claims Against Germany to negotiate for compensation and restitution on behalf of the victims of the Holocaust. Afro-descendants, the key to self-determination and reparations is our collective unity backed by the Afro-descendant nation.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. That's right.
Backed by the Afro-descendant nation.
That's right, Chief. Yes, sir.
You just heard from the Republicans, right?
Yes, sir. Come on.
Black man. It's going to have to be a paradigm shift in your thinking. We want to go or follow the right path. The Honorable Silas Muhammad is on record as saying, you have the legal right to self-determination.
Yes, sir.
And we should follow his lead, which echoes Article 1 of the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. All peoples have the right of self-determination. By virtue of that right, they freely determine their political status.
Yes, sir.
and freely pursue their economic, social, and cultural development. Don't you want to control your own destiny?
Yes, sir.
I know I want to control my own destiny.
No doubt.
Never again is the Jews' motto. Afro-descendants, what is your motto?
Yes, sir.
Every culture on this earth honors their ancestors. And our duty as Afro-descendants is to make sure that the world does not forget the greatest Holocaust in human history. Should we not commemorate Black Holocaust Remembrance Day?
Yes, sir.
There's no power existing in the heavens and earth that will prevent us from honoring our ancestors. Let's take a look at the term Afro-descendants. Afro-descendants is our new political identity. Afro-descendants refers to a people who were forcibly dispossessed of their homeland, Africa, were transported to the Americas and slavery diaspora for the purpose of enslavement, were subjected to slavery, were subjected to forced mixed breeding and rape, have experienced through force the loss of mother tongue, culture, and religion, and have experienced racial discrimination due to lost ties from their original identity. The United Nations and this world will know our day of remembrance when we self-identify and register with the Afro-descendant nation.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
As Afro-descendants.
That's right. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
We must come together like those 23 international Jewish organizations that demonstrated the power of collective unity.
Yes, sir.
The Honorable Silas Muhammad is the person that wrote the definition for the term Afro-descendants. And we fit the definition to the T.
Indeed, certainly.
Is that right?
Yes, sir.
We, the members of the Afro-descendant nation, did not march on Washington, asking Congress to establish a day of remembrance to honor the memory of our ancestors? No! What did we say? Be, and it is.
That's right, that's right.
And that's why we are standing here today.
That's right, yes, sir.
Afro-descendants, you are the people. They know you are the people.
Yes, sir, yes, they do, sir.
They know, but they play possum, if you will. Like they don't know, but they know.
They know.
They know that we are here today.
Indeed, right. They do, sir.
There are scholars and scientists who study or have studied about us.
That's right, yes, sir.
And they know that a voice should be coming up out of the Black man and woman in America, and that term self-determination should be coming up out of our people.
Yes, sir. That's
right. They know.
Yes, sir. They know, Chief.
They know, but they'll keep you blind, deaf, and dumb, keeping you distracted. The housewives of this, the housewives of that, the housewives of this.
Come yes, on. Sir. Come on. Distraction. That's right.
That's right. In 2014, on International Holocaust Remembrance Day, former President Barack Obama called on people from around the world to remember the Jews who were murdered in Nazi Germany. why didn't he call on the world to honor the memory of the victims of the Black Holocaust?
Right, right. Good question, Chief. Good question.
North America, Latin America, in the Caribbean and the slavery diaspora.
That's right.
Come on. Afro descendants, after 467 years in America, there is still no justice. There is no possible defense for 310 years of slavery. No possible defense for forced mixed breeding and rape. No defense for Jim Crow. No defense for segregation. No defense for lynching. 100 years of lynching. The unjust incarceration, police brutality, and ongoing injustice perpetrated against Afro descendants. You haven't touched the pain. I have. Have you ever looked into a man who's serving 200 years plus life? I have. Have you ever looked into the eyes of a man who's serving 100 years unjustly? I'm talking about touching the pain. I'm not afraid. Not me. Not me. All of this wrongdoing, he can't hide it. Let me share something with you. We can't find it. Right here in the nation's capital, right here in Washington, D.C., in 1965, President Lyndon Baines Johnson gave a commencement speech at Howard University. And President Johnson left a profound message on justice exactly 100 years after slavery was abolished. And this is what he said about American justice. It is to fulfill the fair expectations of man. Thus, American justice is a very special thing. For from the first, this has been a land towering expectations. It was to be a nation where each man could be ruled by the common consent of all enshrined in law, given life by institutions, guided by men themselves, subject to its rule in all of every station and origin would be touched equally in obligation and liberty. Beyond the law laid a land. It was a rich land glowing with more abundant promise than man had ever seen. Here, unlike any place yet known, all were to share the harvest and beyond. This was the dignity of man. Each could become whatever his qualities of mind and spirit would permit, to strive, to seek, and if he could, to find his happiness. This is American justice. President Johnson continued. He said, we have pursued it, meaning justice. We have pursued it faithfully to the edge of our imperfection. and we have failed. We have failed to find it for the American Negroes.
Listen, listen.
Did you hear that?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Johnson, a sitting president of the United States of America, freely admitted to the world that the American government is incapable of treating us with justice.
Yes, sir.
100 years after slavery was abolished, the American government found justice for Native Americans whose land that they stole.
Think about it.
The American government found justice for Japanese Americans wrongfully put in concentration camps during World War II. America, Great Britain, France, and the United Nations put pressure on Germany and forced Germany to pay over $90 billion as of today. Do you hear me?
Yes, sir.
$90 billion. And what have the slaves and their descendants received? Think about it. I said it, I say it again, brothers and sisters. America does not love you like she loved herself. Would your mother tell you to keep running behind a man or a woman that doesn't love you? Or would she say, let them alone? You know and I know that Afro descendants have had a rocky relationship with America. Am I right or wrong?
Yes, right. 100%.
We all know that we are treated like second-class citizens. Or are we really citizens? Have you ever heard the soul classic by Junior Walker and the All-Stars? Well, you got to be about 60 and above. He made a song, he recorded a song titled, What Does It Take to Win Your Love? Our people are still running behind somebody that don't love them.
That's right, Chief. It's crazy.
My mother would have told me, said, boy, you, what's wrong with you? I raised you better than that. Mm. But you know, if we do not stand together in unity and exercise the power of self-determination,
come on.
Don't you know that that would be a betrayal to our ancestors?
Yes, yes, sir.
Not only that, it would be a betrayal to your children and grandchildren, yes, sir. Not to prepare a future for them.
That's right. Yes, sir.
Black man, Afro-descendant, you got to put that foolishness down, man.
Yes, sir.
75% of black households are headed by black women. Those statistics are staggering.
Indeed they are, sir.
Black man, you got to get your head on straight.
Yes, sir.
Are you expecting justice from the American government? It will never happen. The American government has not paid reparations to Afro descendants. Therefore, we must go to the United Nations and have them act as an independent arbitrator.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
We are not going to Capitol Hill.
No, sir. No, sir.
You already done showed us with 33 years with that H.R. 40 bill.
Right. Yes, sir. Come on. That's right.
We are Afro descendants.
Yes, sir.
And this is your Black Holocaust Remembrance Day 2022. Let's continue with our commemorations.
Yes, sir.
Because I have some information that I want to impart, that I want to give you, so you will be able to have it, so you will be able to feel that pain. And so you will have that understanding, the importance of language. Language is part of what makes us human. It has raised man from a savage state to a state of civility. Man cannot become a full human without language. Philosopher John Stuart Mill said, language is the light of the mind. Now, let's just stop here for a moment. Suppose you could speak Spanish, and you happen to be around some Hispanics, and you start speaking Spanish, and their face will light up because of language. They know the value of language. The language one speaks connects them to their culture, their religion, and identity. People have a human right to speak their mother tongue. Language is a way people preserve their religion, culture, and identity. When there is destruction of language or mother tongue, and this act coupled with forced mixed breeding and rape, the language and the original identity can never be restored. Therefore, the wrong is ongoing. The key factor is retaining original identity and language. Therefore, the wrong is ongoing. Silas Muhammad, he knew that if a law has been violated, and there is no remedy available, reparations are due. And this is the legal foundation under international law. America is in violation of Article 27 of the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. The covenant says, in those states in which ethnic, religious, or linguistic minorities exist, persons belonging to such minorities shall not be denied the right in community with other members of their group to enjoy their culture, to profess and practice their own religion, or to use their own language. All other ethnic groups in America can speak their mother tongue, except Afro descendants. Our mother tongue was purposely destroyed during slavery. That is not so with all other ethnic groups in America and throughout the diaspora. Natural tongue. The natural tongue that one speaks is referred to as one's mother tongue. And the natural intelligence that a person has before going to school is called mother with, not father with. It's called mother with. Because everything a child knows before it gets to school, it learns from its mother, not father. And if it, meaning a child, never goes to school, whatever native intelligence it has, it got it primarily from its mother, not its father. So it's called mother with. And the mother is also the one who teaches the child how to speak the language. So the natural tongue is called mother tongue.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Whenever you find as many as 48.2 million not able to to speak mother tongue? Right there. That's evidence that something was done to our mother. Do you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Something had to happen to our mother.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
They had laws in those days that made it mandatory for a black child to be taken from their mother as fast as the child was born. The mother never had a chance to rear it. The child was brought up somewhere else, away from the mother. So the mother couldn't teach the child what she knew about itself, about its past, about its heritage. It would have to grow up in complete darkness, knowing nothing about the land where it came from, not even about its own mother. There was no relationship between the black child and its mother. It was against the law. And if the master would ever find any of those children who had any knowledge of its mother tongue, that child was put to death. They had to stamp out the language. They did it scientifically.
Yes, sir.
If they found any one of them that could speak it, off went its head. They would put it to death. They would kill it in front of the mother, if necessary. This is the history of how they took your language. Do you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Our foremothers were victims of forced mixed breeding and rape during plantation slavery. I would like to now move to this next subtopic, destruction of identity and the process of forced mixed breeding and rape. There were no laws to protect them. It was the slave master that named our ancestors Negro. When they were brought from Africa in chains, they weren't called Negro.
No, sir.
They wasn't called color. $48.2 million Afro-descendants descended from enslaved Africans in America. The children that were produced through forced mixed breeding and rape were neither full-blooded African nor full-blooded Caucasian. Let me say that again. The children that were produced through forced mixed breeding and rape were neither a full-blooded African nor a full-blooded Caucasian. Africans and Caucasians are a different race of people, yes. Are two different and distinct people.
Indeed, sir.
Forced interbreeding of the two races created a hybrid called Negro. You different. You're not the same people that left Africa. Those people that left Africa was mailbox black.
Yes, sir.
And look how many different shades we have today as a result of forced mixed breeding and rape.
Yes, sir.
A lady from Puerto Rico and I was conversing about 40 million Afro descendants at that time that could I asked her the question, what did she think about 40 million Afro descendants who could not speak their mother tongue or their language? She looked. She said, that's a lot of damage. A lot of damage. A lot of damage. What you don't realize is that all the other ethnic groups have something that you don't have.
Come on, Minister.
And that's mother tongue.
Yes,
and they
sir.
Know the value of it.
Yes, sir.
They interact with you, but they know that there's something that you just don't have. An African told me, he said, when I first came to America and interacted with Afro descendants, they couldn't speak the language. He said, they couldn't talk. That's what he said to me. They couldn't talk. So we are completely different people.
Yes, we are, Chief. Yes, sir.
There's no doubt about that. You are not American. I asked two twin Palestinian brothers the same question. Those two Palestinian brothers told me that they are nothing people.
Wow.
Are nothing people. That's what the two Palestinian brothers told me. And I had never heard the term a nothing people until I read a statement by the Honorable Silas Muhammad. And I said, wow. I had never seen the Palestinian brothers. And they said the same thing that Silas Muhammad said. I said that there is something to this. I was talking with a Mexican. See, I interact. I want to know. And this Mexican was telling me about how America annexed Mexico in the War of 1812. The Mexican told me that they took Texas, Mexico, New Mexico, Arizona, California, and Nevada. That's why they're coming across the border, because they see that as their land that America took. Is everybody all right?
Yes, sir.
Because I have some information I want to give you. 48.2 million Afro descendants cannot speak their mother tongue, nor can they speak any of the estimated 2,000 languages spoken on the African continent. How familiar are you with any of the 54 countries in Africa? You can name many of the governments, the tribes, the culture, or flags, but you cannot speak your mother tongue. If you boarded an airplane tomorrow to Africa, which of the 54 countries would you go to? I'm talking about damage now.
Yes, sir.
Which one of the 54 countries would you go to? At one time, we were called slave, Negro, color, black, and African American. We are the only people whose identity changes like the seasons. A Chinese is a Chinese from the cradle to the grave.
Yes, sir.
Now, I would like for you to name your relative that will pick you up at the airport when you arrive in Africa. If you cannot speak any African language, you are not African. Language is what connects you to your religion, culture, and identity. Moving to my next subtopic. Mule. Mule. You say, well, Minister, what are you talking about? Mule. It was the male donkey and the female horse that produced the mule. A mule is not a full-blooded donkey or full-blooded horse. The mule is different. The mule is a hybrid. The mule is a sterile animal. It cannot reproduce itself. Likewise, we are unable to return to being African. Why? Because of forced mixed breeding and race. Before continuing with my lecture, let's go to the video.
Good boy. Wallace's beginnings were beyond humble. Half horse, half donkey, he was abandoned in Ireland. The Sidmouth Donkey Sanctuary rescued him and he was rehomed. And that's when his journey to dressage began.
When I got Wallace, I realised that he had good potential. He was bright, he was happy, and he could do more.
But to get Wallace to this point wasn't easy. Normally only open to horses and ponies, British dressage found itself accused of equine racism and as a result changed its rules. And as star of the show, Wallace has attracted many admirers.
He's really cute.
He's just amazing. It's really good to see diversity as well. It's just amazing. Every horse, whatever they look like, should be able to compete.
He loves his ears being scratched.
But some horses were rather alarmed.
As a very novice dressage rider, it's just a little off-putting for me, but we're dealing with it, you know. We will get back on in a bit and go and do another test and just pray that he's not there. She seems very affected by him, lots of snorting and excitement, but I guess that's just normal. She knows he's similar, but not the same as her.
Well, despite the mixed reactions, everyone here will have to get used to him, because the hope is this is the start of something special.
We're really pleased. Big, big day. We made history today. Everyone as a team, BD, Wallace, everyone made history.
A day to remember and a result to remember. As the scores were counted up, Wallace had won. Victory for a mule and a canter towards equine equality. Janine Jansen, BBC Spotlight.
What a good boy.
Okay. The mule is not only sterile, but also of mixed race. The origin of the word mulatto is born of a crossbreed between a donkey and a horse. Both of those traits were viewed as unnatural. A mule has neither pride of ancestry nor hope of posterity. There are six different classes of mules. Sugar mule, cotton mule, levee mule, rice mule, mine mule, railroad mule. Further research show that there's a seventh mule, and that seventh mule is a tobacco mule. What do the mule and the slave have in common? Both are hybrids. Do you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Both are hybrids. Think about that clip that you just saw. Let's go a little further to show you the impact of forced mixed breeding and rape. Historian Edwin Embry in Brown American, page 180, stated, by the time of the Civil War, there were few Negroes left in the country of purely African blood. The mulatto was bred in the South by white men from helpless slave women. Let me take it a step further, because I want to make it plain. I've done research for you so that you will know that you are Afro descendant, that you are a new people, yes, that sir. You are different.
Yes, sir.
You have to understand that.
Yes, sir.
Scholar Thomas Sowell said it best. On page 183 in his book, Ethnic America, in more than two centuries of bondage, many ancestral languages and cultures faded away, and their genetic differences were amalgamated together with substantial mixture of Caucasian genes to produce, now listen at this now, to produce the American Negro, a cultural and biological product of the New World rather than a direct descendant of any given African nation or culture.
Yes, sir.
We are new people. We are new people. We are a new people. Given the fact that we are a different people, culturally, linguistically, and genetically, is proof that our ancestors' inherent human rights were destroyed. It was damaged to the extent that we, their descendants, are no longer African. We are not the same people we once were in Africa because of destruction of our language and our original identity.
Yes, sir.
There's no race or nation which has been called from their beginning Negroes. This is a slang that the slave master and his children has given to the American black slave after he had been successful in depriving our fathers of the knowledge of self. They made us neutral. We were not respected as a member of societies of the earth, nor by him because of his lack of knowledge of self in others. You are a completely different people.
Yes, sir. That's correct, sir.
You're different. And all other ethnic groups in America know it. And the white man, he knows it. Go and search ancient history of the black man of the earth, and it will prove that not one time were Negroes or colored people living in Asia or Africa. How did we come by these names? The names are from the slave master. Am I boring you?
No, sir.
In his oral statement to the 57th Subcommittee on the Promotion and Protection of Human Rights, August 2005, Agenda Item 5C, Prevention of Discrimination and Protection of Minorities, the Honorable Silas Muhammad made a clear distinction between Afro-descendants and people of African descent. Silas Muhammad said, there is a vast difference between Afro-descendants and people of African descent. While we enjoy the same comely color, we both view ourselves as being different. People of African descent still have their original identity,
yes, they do, sir.
Their mother tongue,
yes, sir.
Their culture, and their religion. While Afro-descendants mimic the mother tongue, culture, and religion of our slave master's children. I want you to think about that. Our identity, our dignity, and thus our essence was taken. We collectively are rendered a stateless people by the deprivation of those most precious human rights as defined by Article 27 of the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. People of African descent can enjoy the comfort of their tribal kinship and the protection of their government. We Afro-descendants cannot. We have only the United Nations to look to and the hopes of protection. Moving along, Emmett Till, in 1955, was murdered, shocking the entire world. His death began the civil rights movement. 67 years later, the US Congress named the anti-lynching bill after him. Isn't that a long time? 67 years? And you still love America? You still believe in America? Our humanity is greater than any political party. His death is a complete violation of justice in the law. The torture and killing of Emmett Till can only be interpreted as the act of a savage beast. One hundred years of lynching. In the back of this book is a partial listing of 5,000 people that was lynched since 1859. Let me hold it up again. 100 years of lynching. This is a part of America's history record. 100 years of lynching. And I advise you to get you a copy and read it. And once you read this and feel this pain, you won't be the same.
Yes, sir.
You would want self-determination.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
That's what you would want.
Yes, sir. Look out.
Andrew Hacker wrote a book, Two Nations, Black and White, Separate, Hostile, and Unequal. What is it that you don't understand? Or do you just love America? I don't love nobody that treat me unjustly. Not me. But I think S.I. Sheinfeld said it best in his book, Books of Sheinfeld. This is a Caucasian Jew. I want you to listen to him because he know his nature better than you. But you know us, we argue against him. And he know his nature better than you. And you just start reading about 150 years ago.
That's right. Come on. Yes, sir.
This was a Jew. He was a rabbi, chief rabbi. He said, I suspect deep in our souls, we yearn for our savage, primitive past, when we were free to give expression to our inherent violent nature. That might explain it. Inherent violent nature. 100 years of lynching. 310 years of slavery.
Yes, sir. Come on.
This man is talking about these people's nature. It's got to be something. We got to put our finger on it, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
We've been there for 467 years. We know what it is. Those of us has been taught, we know.
Yes, sir.
But I wanted to bring the white version to you.
Yes, sir. That's right.
Since you won't accept the black version, here's the white version. Let me say it again, because I want it to sink in.
Yes, sir.
Now, I'm not beating you over the head. I'm not beating you over the head. I'm just trying to share some information with you. I suspect deep in our souls, we yearn for our savage primitive past when we were free to give expression to our inherent violent nature.
Wow.
This got to be the truth.
Yes, sir.
We have 100 years of lynching.
Yes, sir.
We have two nations, black and white, separate, hostile, and unequal.
Listen.
Self-determination is the key.
Self-determination. Yes, sir.
Speaking about law, John Davenier, born in the 1760, said, laws that allow us to diminish the humanity of anyone are not laws, they are frameworks for crime. We are here. The voice is here. The voice of self-determination is here.
Yes, sir. We got to talk. Rise up, guys.
Slavery was America's weapon of mass destruction.
Yes, sir.
Wiping away our ancestors' collective memory through congressional legislation. These evil acts diminished our humanity forever. It removed us from the human family.
Yes, sir.
That's why we need UN recognition.
Yes, sir.
Because they kicked us out of the human family. Mm. You know it's the truth.
Yes, sir, it is.
I'm gonna walk you down this path so that you won't go to Capitol Hill.
Yes, sir.
Your brother's here to guide you on the right path.
Yeah, that's right. Yes, sir.
That's right.
The late Dr. Ranoko Rashidi, a world traveler, archaeologist, anthropologist, said these words, and I hope you listen closely. He said, history is a people's memory. Never minimize this. For when you lose your memory, you lose your identity. And when you lose your identity, you are lost. In many ways, those of us brutally taken from our motherland have lost history, memory, and identity. And this we suffer from this today, whether we realize it or not. Let's continue to move further, because I want to show you the value of identity. I want to show you what many of our people don't understand, because you're walking around saying that I'm African American. You're not African American.
No, sir. No, sir.
You don't enjoy the same rights that white people enjoy. Mm. We are the only people that march every year. I don't see the Japanese marching. I don't see the Koreans marching. Unless they are marching with our people because they feel sorry. Well, let's just march, but we know they're treating them, treating them bad. They've been here ever since or before the Constitution.
Yes, sir.
And the immigrant just came across the ocean and he's enjoying all the privileges that you don't enjoy.
Wow.
Something is wrong with that black man. No. You got to come out of that deep sleep that you're in.
Yes, sir.
Now listen to this. Identity is something that cannot be found. It must be created. That's one scholar. Or I should say, I'm going to continue with this scholar's statement. He said, the American Negro has been subjected to a system designed to destroy ambition, prevent independence, and erode intelligence for the past 350 years. He goes on to say, nothing could be more foolish or more damaging to the Negro cause than to face the harsh reality of what 350 years of white oppression has done to the Negro personality and behavior. He continues, 100 years after its abolition, Negroes are still bound by its effects on their conscience, on their mind and spirit. I want you to listen now. Now, this is Andrew Hacker, the author of Two Nations, Black and White, Separate, Hostile, and Unequal. So to a far greater degree than for immigrants from other lands, it rests on you to create your own identity.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
It rests on you.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And those 19 countries, they came together.
Yes, sir. Yes,
am
sir.
I right?
Yes, sir. That's right.
Afro descendants.
Yes, sir.
That's who we are. That's who you are.
Yes, sir.
Come on.
And we must spread this.
Yes, sir.
You must self-identify with the Afro descendant nation.
Yes, sir. That's right.
This is your nation.
That's right, Chief.
We will back you.
That's right. Yes, sir.
America did not back the H.R. 40 bill. We'll fight for reparations for you.
That's right.
We'll back you.
Yes, sir.
The
yes,
same
sir.
Way that Israel yes, backed the Holocaust
yes,
about
sir.
It.
That's right. That's right, Chief. Yes, sir.
I want you to listen to Ralph Ellison now. Ralph Ellison said in his essay, in 1948, he said, Negro Americans are desperate search for an identity. rejecting the second-class status assigned to them, they feel alienated, and their whole lives have become a search for answers to the question, who am I? What am I? Why am I? And where? Let me go a step further.
Come on, Chief. Yes, sir.
The Honorable Silas Muhammad said, we have suffered many atrocities in America, but the greatest damage that was done to us was destruction of original identity. Despite our heroic struggles and sacrifices, most of us are still unaware that we have a human right to our identity.
Yes, sir.
And we were stripped of that right. We were forced to assume the identity of the people who enslaved us, and that rendered us non-existent, not recognized under international law. That assumption of another's identity also renders us second-class citizens, making us susceptible to other indignities, such as racism, exclusion, exploitation, discrimination, racial profiling, and unequal protection of the law.
That's right, yes, sir. Come on.
Do you understand?
Yes, sir.
Moving a little further, because I want you to feel our ancestors' pain. I'm coming from the book, American Slavery as It Is. Testimony of 1,000 witnesses. I want you to listen to this description. I don't want you to separate yourself. Or let me say this before I go into this. I went to George Washington plantation home in Mount Vernon. And I went into the slave quarters. And when I went into the slave quarters, I said, no, they didn't live like this, no. My mind was turning. And there were white people who would come into the slave quarters, and they would see me, and I guess they saw that I was in deep thought, and they would leave. And when me and my 9-year-old daughter, Saliyah, at that time, as we walked away, she said to me, Dad, that's a damn shame. I couldn't chastise her because she told the truth, right?
Yes, sir.
Now I want you to listen to this description of the condition of our people. I want you to hang in with me because I have information. This is Black Holocaust Remembrance
Day. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Now, if you need to check your stock on Wall Street, okay, I understand if that's what you have to do. But I don't think many of you have to check your stock on Wall Street. You just want an excuse to leave. Follow them next to their huts, some with and some without floors. Go at night. View their means of lodging. See them lying on benches, some on the floor or ground, some sitting on stools, dozing away the night, others of younger ages with a bear blanket wrapped about them. And one or two lying in the ashes. These things have I often seen with my own eyes. Now, this is a Caucasian observing our people's history, observing our people's pain and how they were mistreated during slavery. He said, these things I have often seen with my own eyes. And he recorded it in this book. Examine their means of subsistence, which consists generally of 7 quarts of meal or 8 quarts of small rice for 1 week. Then follow them to their work with driver and overseer pushing them to the utmost of their strength by threatening and whipping. If they are sick from fatigue and exposure, go to their huts, as I have often been, and see them groaning under burning fever of pleurisy, lying on some straw, their feet to the fire with barely a blanket to cover them, or on some boards nailed together in form of a bedstead. Do you feel that pain?
Yes, sir.
They're sick. Their lungs are in pain. They are coughing because they are working from, can't see in the morning, they can't see at night.
That's right.
Let me continue. And after seeing all this and hearing them tell of their suffering, need I ask, is there any evil connected with their condition? And if so, upon whom is it to be charged? I answer for myself, and the reader can do the same. Our government stands first chargeable for allowing slavery to exist under its own jurisdiction. Second, the states for enacting laws to secure their victims. Third, the slaveholder for carrying out such enactments in horrid form enough to chill the blood. Fourth, every person who knows what slavery is and does not raise his voice against this crying S-I-N, sin, but by silence give consent its continuance, is chargeable with guilt in the sight of God. Let's move on a little further. Before freedom came, I'm talking about touching the pain. You want to separate yourself, but we come from those people. Never forget that. Before freedom came, former slave Robert Totley said, "You see, you sing hog troughs side by side in a big lot after grown niggers eat and get out the way. Scraps and everything eatable was put in those troughs. Sometimes buttermilk poured on the mess and sometimes liquor or pot liquor. Then the cook blowed a cow horn, quick as lightning. A passel of 50 or 60 little niggers running out of the plum bushes from under the sheds and houses and from everywhere. Each one takes his place and sops his hand in the mixture and eat just like you see pigs shoveling around slop troughs. We come from those people.
Yes, sir.
Now, don't you understand that we must stand up?
Yes, sir.
We must demand self-determination?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
We must start a self-determination movement in this country.
That's right. Yes, sir.
For we have went beyond slavery, beyond civil rights. It's time for self-determination. What kind of people would make our forefathers and mothers eat their food from a hog trough? I got something for you. I'm not finished. Everybody's at home. They don't have nothing to do. They can watch the lecture in the comfort of their home, right?
Yes, sir.
They don't have nowhere to go. They could lay up on the couch.
That's right.
In their recliner.
That's right. Very convenient.
Very convenient. If you don't come to us, we'll go to you.
Right. Yes, sir. Right. Yes, sir.
That's right.
For we are in your homes right now.
Yes, sir.
The Harrington family. Now, let me tell you about the Harrington's. I ran across this book called The Harrington's. And I was reading, and as I read that the Harrington had a slave empire in Virginia in 1851, they owned 10,000 slaves, 45 plantations, and numerous satellite. They had satellite plantations in four different states. One of the daughters were given 700 slaves as a wedding gift. They don't teach you that during Black history.
No, sir.
They don't teach you this in school. But you'll get it here at Black Holocaust
That's right,
Remembrance
sir.
Day.
That's right.
That's right. Good knowledge.
The plantation empire grew so large that it almost defies description. The Harrington's, an American family in black and white. Now, I want to bring to your attention about Raleigh. Raleigh, he was an actor. And he was a part of this family. He descended from this family, these Caucasians, these devils. Have you ever watched the comedy called Amen?
Yes, sir.
Well, the elderly gentleman named Raleigh descended from this family, the Harrington's. And Raleigh was some type of actor. Check out his resume. Extensive resume. How many of you recognize this man? If you ever watched Amen.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You know him. Well, he is a descendant of the Harrington's. White people know that they owe us. They understand the condition
they do, sir.
That they put us in.
They do, sir. Yes, sir.
And they knew our ancestors' value. Let me share something with you about the value of our ancestors. David Blight is a historian at Harvard University. Pardon me, not Harvard, Yale University. In 1860, slaves were the single largest financial asset in the entire American economy. More than all manufacturing, railroads, steamship lines, and transportation systems put together. The only thing in the American economy worth more as simply financial assets was the land itself. Do you understand how valuable our ancestors were to this country?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
If our ancestors were not here, if slavery did not exist, the 13 original colonies would have collapsed. I'm going somewhere. There's a book called Federal Plantation that deals with our Black intelligentsia. They are catching hell just like we are catching hell.
Yes, sir.
They work in the government, but they're being discriminated against. They are catching hell. Don't let nobody tell you that they are not, because their skin is not the right color.
Yes, sir.
Federal Plantation. It is political suicide and political politics seeking reparations from the U.S. Congress. We should not be seeking justice from the defendant when we are the victims, plaintiff. The U.S. government is the defendant. They are the one that's harmed us. What does it look like a person, a woman that's been raped, going to the rapist, asking for justice?
Good point, sir.
In 2009, the 111th U.S. Senate passed the Constitutional Resolution 26 as an apology bill for slavery and segregation, with a disclaimer that said nothing in this resolution authorizes or supports any claim against the United States or serve as a settlement of any claim against the United States. Let me go a little further. In 1810, after our ancestors produced 93 million pounds of cotton and most of 84 million pounds of tobacco and didn't receive a red penny, America, you mean to say that you don't want us to receive full and complete reparations for our labor? You better take another look at America. That's the wrong path. Your brother's trying to point you to the right path.
Yes, sir.
The path of self-determination.
Yes, sir.
That path that will take you to the beyond.
Indeed, yes, sir.
Do you expect to get reparations? And Senator Mitch McConnell is in the Senate. Mitch McConnell said, I share Obama's position on reparations. We both oppose reparations, and we both are descendants of slaveholders. Think about that now. Think about that. Think about that. And think about what President Johnson said. We fail to find justice for the American Negro. We're gonna have to go elsewhere. The United Nations is the only place we can pursue justice from America for their violations of our human rights. Nothing is more important to our future as a people other than self-determination. I'm almost finished. Together, we must move swiftly to achieve it and register as Afro descendants.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Our new political identity is recognized by the United Nations.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Collective unity and brotherhood is our focal point. For a historical perspective, here's a letter from the Honorable Elijah Muhammad to Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., dated July 6, 1966, that dispels any disunity between these giant ancestors. A letter to Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Dear sir, let us come together in a meeting to discuss the future plans and programs needed to achieve these goals for our people. If we have any love and respect for each other, let us be intelligent about the matter and present to America and all the world a united Black front. The destiny of 22 million Black people is too important to allow disunity among us to prevent our achievement of a united front of Black Americans. The meeting nor the place need to be public. Please let me have your answer within 10 days. Cordially, your brother, Elijah Muhammad. Now watch this. Now the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said that he's the brother of Dr. King. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
Because we're going to put this divide, we're going to put it to rest. Now, is it anywhere we can find in the teachings of Dr. King where he said Elijah Muhammad was his brother? You never read it. Well, it's time that we read it now. In the book At Canaan's Edge by Taylor Branch, page 297, he quotes Dr. Martin Luther King. He said these words, Elijah Muhammad is my brother, even though our methods are different.
Yes, sir.
Did you hear that?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So we are brothers. We might be from different schools of thoughts, but we're still Afro descendants, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So that should settle that issue, right?
Yes, sir. Definitely.
It's time for us to come together. It's time for this self-determination movement.
Yes, sir.
That's the order of the day.
Yes, sir.
Self-determination. Self-determination movement.
Let's go. Yes, sir.
Clearly, we see self-determination is the role we are to take as a people. And it is the ultimate unifying force. We must come together. Remember, black man, remember Afro descendant, especially the males. Remember the Holocaust survivors and the state of Israel received $90 billion for the damages that Hitler caused them. Look at the damage that America has caused us.
Yes, sir. That's right.
America destroyed our essence. Now, I think you're going to have to rethink what manhood is, because the score is 90 billion to zero, black man.
That's right.
You got to do something about that.
Yes, sir.
I know that you will kill concrete, but what about that zero right there?
That's right.
Don't bring me nothing else. I want to know what you're going to do about the zero. Afro descendants. We are reminded by the Honorable Silas Muhammad. You have the legal right to self-determination like every other people. Self-determination is real freedom. 48.2 million Afro descendants must control their own destinies.
Yes, sir.
Self-determination is the issue that unites us. Self-determination will resolve our issues. Self-identity, collective unity, and the power of self-determination is what this Black Holocaust Remembrance Day is about.
Yes, sir.
We can never forget where we as a people came from and the blessings that are in store for us when we work together. Before leaving you, I'd like to mention that we must build a self-determination movement.
Yes, sir. Come on.
We must build it in America.
That's right. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
We must shout from the rooftop that we are Afro descended.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Come on.
Afro descended, not African American. No, Afro descended.
Afro descended. That's right.
We must build a self-determination movement in America for the greater good of our people. No one else is coming.
Nobody. That's
right. Ain't nobody coming.
That's right.
You can say whatever you want to say. Ain't nobody coming but us.
That's right.
Yes, sir.
That's it.
Those who have sacrificed for you. We're waiting on you to come and help us.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. That's right.
We were not the only people in slavery. It's 48.2 million descendants of us.
Yes, right.
We will back you. America is not going to back you.
No, sir.
It's not going to back the H.R. 40 bill. That's a trick.
That's right.
That's a trap. Rosie promises.
That's it.
33 years.
That's all.
We are beyond child slavery. We are beyond the civil rights movement. And today, we are preparing a future for our children
right.
and grandchildren.
Yes, sir.
Take pride. And being Afro descendant.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chief.
We'd like to thank all of you who have attended and all of you who have watched all across America and outside of America.
Yes, sir.
We ask you, before we leave you, to donate whatever you can online. You can donate online or by mail. It is your choice. But donate to help this movement.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
We need your support.
Yes, sir.
Your identity has been explained to you as Afro-descendant.
Yes, sir.
That movement will be moving across America and the diaspora.
Yes, sir.
For those of you who may still be stuck at H.R. 40. Because I know, I feel you. I would recommend you go and read a paper that John Conyers did. And he wrote on reparations, the legislative agenda. He did this at a conference at the Thomas Jefferson School of Law. You read it for yourself. I'm just going to give you one snippet of it, but go pull it down and read it. Here is what I want you to hear.
Yes, sir.
He says, I think back to the conference on racism that United Nations held in Durban. You're familiar with that.
Yes, sir.
How many of you remember that?
Yes, sir.
I was there. He was there. And probably some of you were there as well. The thing that they kept telling us in the American group,
yes, sir,
was, please don't raise the subject of reparations.
Wow.
Can you hear that?
Yes, sir.
Don't raise it, John. Don't talk about it, John. Don't bring it up.
Don't bring it up. Yes, sir.
Can you hear it?
Yes, sir.
You're caged in. You're caged in the white civilization. You're caged in. They don't want you out. They don't want you free. You heard the message. We thank you. We honor our ancestors by standing today.
That's right. Yes, sir.
And saying no more.
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 Good evening. One more time. Donations. Yes, we need them. So go online. Donate whatever you can. Because this movement will move like the train,
yes, sir,
across America and the diaspora. You can also donate by sending your funds to the CEO of the Lost Foundation of Islam Incorporated by mail. Do so, please.
Yes, sir.
We will move this movement across the world.
Yes, sir.
Have a good evening.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. All right. Yes, sir.